This is Mark Kepler, Purdue Extension Service here in Fulton County. I got an opportunity today to come out to the community garden here on 6th Street. We're going to take a look at some things that are going on in our community as far as diseases that are out here in vegetable plants. And so this is my opportunity to do that today. I have gotten a lot of calls this year on a problem in tomato plants. And we're going to look at some of these problems in these tomato plants. A lot of it is related to the amount of rainfall we've gotten this past year. And these two problems are fungus diseases. And if you take a look at a disease situation, what you end up having to have is you have to have the disease, the susceptible plant, which is the tomato plant in this situation, and the right kind of weather. So all the rainfall we had early on this spring allows that rain to stay on the leaves of those plants. And so when that fungal disease comes along, the spores are out here floating along. They come in, they land on that film of water, and they actually germinate, kind of like a seed does, and just starts growing a little thing called a hyphae right into that plant and growing down there and hurting that plant. So let's take a look at these tomato plants right behind me here. Very typical of a tomato plant this year. And that is, at the bottom of the plant, we start seeing some leaves start to die off. That's because the fungus comes out as a spore, and the spores are probably been laying on the ground from production in past years. And those spores then will splash up to the under leaves. And so that's why it starts on the bottom. This disease, there's actually two of them, called early blight and septoria leaf spot. Septoria leaf spot is a disease that puts these spots that we're going to take a look at here on these on this tomato plant. So we see the spots right here on the leaves of this plant, and that's septoria leaf spot. Early blight will give it more of this dying on the edges, like this plant has here, more of that overall area that's dead down in through there. And that's what we look like with early blight. These are both fungus diseases. And what you have to do is you have to protect the plant from getting that disease. And the way you protect the plant from getting that disease is to put a fungicide spray on it that protects it. Now, we don't have, as homeowners, sprays that are available to us that actually cures this problem. We can only protect it. So if we go ahead and spray this plant with a fungicide and coat the leaves, think of it as kind of a protection on those leaves. And it'll prevent these spores from splashing up and germinating and growing on those leaves. Now, the problem is some of these leaves already have that disease on it, but we don't see it right now. But it is on there, and so that disease will come up on there, and it'll go ahead. Lots of times what I normally see is with this disease, by the time we get to that normal frost date in October, our tomato plants are already have been killed off from this disease. This year, because of the rainfall, because of the wetness early on, we'll start seeing these tomato plants die well before that time. And so we'll be seeing these die along that line. So on this plant here, a fungicide, and the fungicide that's the most common and the one that's available in our community is one called Daconil. That's the brand name, D-A-C-O-N-I-L. And it contains a fungicide with the active ingredient, chlorothenil. And so that's what we look at for our community. Let's spray this plant, probably before the rain, make sure we do it before the rain, and protect it during that time period. So this is septoria leaf spot, and this is also early blight on tomatoes. And this is the problem we're seeing in our area. We've moved to another location in the garden, and we're going to be taking a look at some zucchini plants here. And this one really affords me an opportunity to look at a multiple number of problems that this plant is having. In fact, this plant we're going to be taking a look at is an absolute disaster. And this is where the insects and diseases that we have in gardening just come together and really make it very difficult to grow some plants. So let's take a look at this zucchini down here. Nobody wants their zucchini to look like this, wilted down and having all sorts of problems associated with it. First off, let's talk about why these plants are wilted to begin with. The wilt comes from an insect called the squash vine borer. Soon after these plants are put into the ground and have an opportunity to start growing, about the time that normal squash plants would start to put out runners, these zucchinis are bush type, so they don't put out that runner. But about that time, there's a moth comes along. It doesn't really even look like a moth. and it comes down and it lays its eggs down towards the base of this plant. Those eggs hatch out into a worm called the squash vine borer. That borer then ends up burrowing into this stalk, and on this plant we've got right here today, there is one of those worms right in there. And the reason this plant is wilting down is because that worm has tunneled in there and essentially is tunneling through the main part of the stalk, and so moisture cannot get up into the upper leaves up here, which causes this thing to wilt down. My recommendation to people is, once you get to that plant, is get to that size where it starts to grow and starts to take off, we have to put an insecticide spray down towards the base. Don't need it on the leaves, but just down in towards the base to try to control this insect, because once he's inside of there, it's very difficult to try to control him. Now, I know people that come along with things like razor blades and cut into that stalk and try to cut him with the stalk, but the damage is already done. Once they've got to this point, they have really affected the yield, and these plants will start wilting down on us. The insecticide that most gardeners could use is that common one called 7, and another one we call permethrin, P-E-R-M-E-T-H-R-I-N. Those are two insecticides that sprayed down in this area would help control this squash vine borer. Again, you take a look at that, it's bored right up in there. So that's one of the problems it's got. That's the biggest problem it's got. But now, later on in the season, another thing starts to happen, and we start seeing these gray insects trotting around it, and it's called a squash bug. And a squash bug is something that once the zucchini start coming on and once we have the plant start to develop, the squash bug has a little mouth part that it sticks into the zucchini, and pumpkins is very, very susceptible to this, and it starts drawing the juices out of it. And at some point you can see these gray bugs just covering a pumpkin later on in the season. About the time we get into September and really start looking at a harvest of a pumpkin, these are really, really bad. So these gray bugs are called squash bugs. And on this plant, one of the ways you can tell it is, you see these gray insects down here, and also besides that, the insect eggs are on the leaves. On this leaf right here, this little group of reddish looking things are the eggs from that insect. And so we'll take a look at a lot of the different leaves in this plot, and we can see how these eggs will be found in this situation. So again, I need to take a look at an insecticide to try to control this. First off, when they're eggs, no insecticide is going to touch them. They're going to hatch out and be tiny little insects to begin with before that insecticide is going to work on them. And so that's when we want to use an insecticide. I mentioned using 7 down below for the squash vine borer, but for the squash bug, 7 really has very little effect on them. Over the years, those insects have built up a tolerance to that, and so we have to use other types of insecticides, like that permethrin I referred to earlier, would be one of those things that can be used on these squash bugs. The other thing about these squash bugs, come wintertime, they'll come visit you in your house and in your garage and locations like that. Many times you'll find them behind things in the garage, and they stink. They absolutely smell, and you will not forget that smell when you've got into these things. It's a pungent, stinky odor that they have associated with them. And so they're bad news. Usually if it's the first time you've ever planted squash, you probably won't see them. By the next year, you'll start seeing them show up and up. So this is the second or third year for this garden here. And again, they found the place, and they'll be here from here on out, and we've got to take care of them. All right, well, that's two things that are wrong with this plant. Let's take a look at a third one that's going on. I picked this plant as a better indicator of what the problem we have here. Now we're going to take a look at a disease that's on this plant. And this is something we call powdery mildew. And if you take a look at this leaf, you can see some white patches that are on that leaf. And that's what powdery mildew looks like. Eventually it takes this whole leaf and it'll wilt it down. In fact, it'll kind of wilt this leaf down and the whole plant will wilt down. But it doesn't look like that wilt situation we have with the other one. With powdery mildew, it kills the leaf off, the stalk will still be sticking up there, and eventually it'll wilt down. Powdery mildew is a disease that has to be contained. You have to use fungicide sprays. About the best fungicide spray available to us for this as homeowners is Daconil. I talked about it earlier as the fungicide we would use on tomato plants, and this is powdery mildew. Daconil will work on that too. There's also a home remedy that of using baking soda and horticulture oil. It's a fine horticulture oil that you can use also to help take care of powdery mildew on these plants. If you think back, if you ever had an opportunity to grow pumpkins, Usually by the end of the season, the leaves on that plant has pretty much turned white, and that white then starts to wilt down those leaves, those weeds start to die off, and eventually it gets down to the pumpkin and gets on the stem of the pumpkin, and there what it ends up doing is it just causes that pumpkin to be not nice and green at harvest, but it tends to be a shriveled up pumpkin stem that easily breaks off. And then that pumpkin, when you take it home and you set it out on your porch, it gives it an avenue for a rotting fungi to get in there and just rot it down on your porch. And so they don't last very long at all. So that's an example of powdery mildew. And that's a problem that we have on a lot of squash plants. And this is a problem we're gonna have on this zucchini, which is a member of the squash family. So that's three things that we can take a look at that's going on with this zucchini out here in the garden. And so it's really, really tough sometime to combat these different diseases. We have to stay on top of the situation. We have to do something about the insects, and we got to be aware of the diseases that come along. Now we've gotten to the cabbage in the garden. And with the cabbage, as you take a look at it, not a whole lot of problems with cabbage except one big one. And actually it's three different ones. And that is the holes that we start seeing in the leaves of this cabbage are caused by worms, and there are a variety of worms that get into these. The cabbage looper and the diamondback moth and the cabbage worm are the three ones that we see in here. And so what they do is they just go through here and they eat the cabbage. And not only do they eat holes in it, and they can really just absolutely riddle this cabbage full of holes, but of course they always leave behind their manure. So what goes in one end, something comes out the other end. So not only do we have holes in it, we got manure covering our cabbages. Not a very good situation to deal with. So one of the options you have to do is you have to look at a control of this insect. Now we've got a lot of insecticides that we've got, and over the years, especially with the case of the diamondback moth, they have become resistant to these insecticides. So now, still, one of the better products to use on this cabbage to try to control those worms is something derived from a natural bacteria found in the soil called Bacillus thuringiensis. I know it's a big word and kind of tough to deal with, but sometimes it's referred to as BT, Bacillus thuringiensis. And it was naturally found in the soil, and they've taken that naturally occurring bacteria and they put it into a powder and a product that you can use where you can spray it on these plants. And so BT sprayed upon these plants will actually be ingested by the insect, and once it's ingested, it'll just cut open its stomach lining and really rip up this insect. It's a little slow acting, but it eventually does the job on them, and it's called BT. Try to get it on while they're very, very young and we first start seeing this kind of a problem. But I would encourage you to use that over all the synthetic insecticides we got. I think that's an excellent one to use. As these plants start to mature and get along in their age, one of the things we start seeing is areas like this on the leaf. And this is a situation called black rot. And if we get a really good close-up of this, we can see little black specks in there, which are the fungus spores that are working on that leaf and causing this disease in that leaf. And this is black rot. It's something you're going to deal with cabbages from time to time, and anytime they get any maturity on them whatsoever, it's a very, very tough one to control. Homeowners don't have a whole lot of choices of what they can do as far as fungicides go. Just realize that that's what's going on in these different cabbages. Well, we've taken a look at a few different things out here as far as tomatoes and squash and cabbage goes, and there's a whole lot of other plants can have a variety of different problems associated with them. We didn't get to see some big green worms at all on those tomato plants this time around. But at the Purdue Extension Service, we're really here to help you with a couple different publications, some things you might do. When we talk about putting on insecticides, fungicides, things like that on these plants, certain ones work on certain things and other ones don't work on others. So it's a good idea to get an idea ahead of time which insecticides, fungicides are the best ones to use for the problem you've got. Our office is at the fairgrounds, and if you want to stop out there sometime with something you've got, we'd be happy to take care of it. I'm Mark Kepler. Thank you. I'm Mark Kepler with Purdue University Extension Service, located in Rochester. And today we're going to be talking about a situation that is going to be very deadly in our community. It's a situation that's been brought about by a bug that has been brought into our area. And this insect is called an invasive species. And we deal with a lot of different invasive species in our area. But this one has the potential to kill every single ash tree that's in our area. And so today we're standing right here near the dam of Lake Manitow, and we've got some ash trees we're going to take a look at, and we're going to explain this situation to you and let you know exactly what's going on in our community and what's happening. The first place to start is the identification of an ash tree. Up until about 10 years ago, I would have told people that an ash tree was one of the best trees that you could have planted in your yard. At that time, what happened was there was a bug that got off a boat up in Detroit, Michigan, and unbeknownst to people, it started invading into the ash trees in that area. And all of a sudden, they started seeing these ash trees that were starting to die all over the place. The U.S. Department of Agriculture came in and investigated that situation and found this insect called the emerald ash borer. Emerald being very bright green, and it only affects ash trees. And it's an important thing for us to understand today that only ash trees are affected by this insect. And so what we're going to do is talk to you about what ash trees are. And I want to start off by looking at the bark on this tree. In our community, most of our street trees that we find trees in our yard are ones that are maples. But so chances are you've got a maple tree in your yard, but if you got an ash tree, this is some of the unique characteristics of that. First thing is we take a look at the bark on this ash tree, and we'll see that that bark has kind of a raised bark, not very flat like many of our maples are, but we see kind of grooves cut into it and bumps on it along that line. And that's one of the aspects of an ash tree that we'll see. It's kind of interesting to look at, but as you look at the bark, they say you can see diamonds in it. And you got to imagine this a little bit when we think about it. But if we look at it, we'll see that the fact that it'll have a point at the top, it widens out and comes together. So this bark kind of forms a diamond formation. And that's part of the thing that we'll see on the bark of that tree. The other thing that we take a look at is the leaves. And so I have in my hand here, this is a really newly formed leaves. They're just coming off this spring of the year. And with an ash tree, instead of having one leaf with one lobe on it like a maple tree does, these are multiple little leaflets. And what we end up seeing is lots of times if you count them, there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 leaflets. They can be 5 to 7 leaflets are all on this. And then they come down to a point down here at the bottom where we have a bud. So this whole thing is actually a leaf, and each one of these have different leaflets on there. So if you think about a maple leaf, it has different lobes on it. Well, in this case, it also has lobes, but they're really deep lobes that come in and look like leaves. So that's what an ash tree would look like. And so what we're really concerned with is the fact that what's going to happen with these ash trees over the next several years. And so let's go take a look at what's going on with these ash trees with this emerald ash borer. Okay, this is an ash tree that another one that's located here in this same area. And we're taking a look at it because we see some damage on this tree. This damage is done by humans. We did something to this. But what I'm really going to look at is what's going on with this ash borer and what's happening. The first thing is this insect has come into this community, and again, I said it jumped off a boat in Detroit and started up through there. And as it went through, it kept coming and coming and coming, and they tried to stop it and they weren't able to stop it. And if you go over to Fort Wayne, Indiana right now, you'll see just about every tree that's in that community that's an ash tree is gone. It's dead. And that's the unique characteristic about this ash borer. It has the ability to kill every single ash tree in this area. Everyone is going to die. And then we're going to talk to you about what happens and how we notice what's going on with these different trees. So on this tree here, the first thing you might be able to notice, and if it was a little earlier in the spring, you would see this. You would see something like this. Areas where the bark have become smooth. Over here, areas where the bark has become smooth. And you'll see a little bit on this other tree, total areas that have been affected that way. This is where a woodpecker has come along, and the woodpecker has found these borers in this tree, and it's flaked off the bark, and eventually you'll see a woodpecker holes start to develop in here. And inside of those woodpecker holes, then he'll get down and get that larva of this emerald ash borer, and he'll pull that out of there, and he'll start consuming it. So what this larva is doing, this green bug comes along, lays its eggs on this tree, the eggs hatch out, and it goes underneath this tree and just barely gets underneath the bark of this tree, which is the live part of the tree. And underneath there, it starts making galleries under there, and it destroys that live part of the tree, and that's why it kills the tree. So let's take a look at this piece of bark right here. It's been kind of pulled off. Let's go ahead and pull it on off of here and take a look and see what's going on underneath that piece of bark. So what's going on is underneath that bark, these little bugs are going along as a larva, which is kind of a worm looking thing, and they're making these grooves. They're making these grooves underneath this bark. And what they'll end up doing is they'll tunnel back and forth and back and forth and back and forth, and so that they'll kill this tree just because the live part of this tree is basically right underneath the bark of this tree. And so that's how the emerald ash borer kills our trees. Here's an ash tree that has an extensive amount of damage done to it. And here's what's going on. Notice how the bark's been flaked off by the woodpeckers. Then the woodpeckers have pounded the holes into this looking for those larvae. And so that's what has going on here. Down below, we've already been out to this tree. And we've taken a knife and peeled off some of the bark to look below it to see the damage that's already been done. And you can see the tunnels that have been underneath that bark caused by these a variety of insects, these emerald ash borers that have been underneath that bark. So this tree at this point right now is definitely infected with this emerald ash borer. The real question is, how long of a life does this tree have left in it? And the answer to that is it's got several years of life. In fact, it'll leaf out this year and look fairly healthy. And then over the next couple of years, we're going to see it start to have branches die off and branches die off to the point that I would say that within the next 5 years, this tree probably will be dead. And because of that, that's why every single ash tree is going to end up dying in probably over the next 10 years in our area. And ash is a very important tree that we have in our yards, and this is one of them we're going to be losing. So homeowners have to start thinking about some things. And the next thing we're going to talk about is what we need to do about this, or if we want to do anything at all about the situation. As a homeowner and a person who may have an ash tree in their yard, you have a decision to make, and that is, when this ash borer comes into my yard, am I going to try to protect this tree through the use of insecticides, or am I going to let it go and have an opportunity to let it go and just let it die? If I am going to let this tree die, then I have cleanup costs, or I have to pay somebody to do that. And although we've got a few years to look at this, next 3, 4, 5 years to look over this, you may want to start making those decisions now and thinking about what you're going to do with that ash tree in your yard. If I'm going to let it go and not worry about it, then I'm going to have it taken out, and I'm going to have somebody paid to take it out. And if that's a situation, I need to look into who's available to do those things. Are they covered by insurance? What kind of a cost is going to be involved into it? Those are issues you need to look at. If you make another decision, and that is, I really want to save this tree, I do not want to lose this tree, then you are looking into the use of insecticides that have to be applied on an every year basis to this tree to help protect that tree. And I've brought along one example of that here today. This is an insecticide that happens to contain the active ingredient, that's the chemical that does the damage, called imidacloprid. And what imidacloprid is a chemical that once we mix this product with water, we dump it on the soil, like it says on the label. It goes down into the roots, it's absorbed by the roots, and it flows up and down in the tree. Now remember earlier I said it's the live part of the tree that where these insects get to. So they're in that area where the flowing is going up and down of that tree, and in that spot then is where they're going to be doing the damage, and so the insecticide gets to them. They're not so much boring down deep into the tree, they're really on the outside portion of the tree. So if I make that decision in my life that I'm going to put an insecticide on this tree year after year after year, this is an example of a product that has imidacloprid in it. It is not the only product out there. There are other ones like this. Bayer has a product in a blue jug that looks that way also. Don't get confused with the fact that it says bug be gone. Ortho has all sorts of bug be gones. And just because that's on the label, that doesn't mean what I want you to know. What I want you to know is to look at that active ingredient on that label and base your decision off that active ingredient. And it also mentions right here on the label that it takes care of the emerald ash borer. So you got a decision to make in your life. Do you have an ash tree? And if you have an ash tree, are we starting to see this kind of damage on it? And that damage means we've got some problems. And you need to think about what you're going to do and how you're going to take care of this, or are you going to do anything at all? You've got a decision to make, and I'm trying to give you enough time to make that decision. But if you're thinking about protecting this tree, get the chemicals out now and start on those. If you're going to let the tree go and stop doing that, then you better think about making that decision about what we're going to do as far as a tree service or somebody to come in and take out our tree. It's not a good situation. There's lots of different invasive species that have come into our areas, and there's a lot of them causing damage in a lot of respects. But I'll tell you right now, this is probably the most economical one that we're going to take a look at. It's going to cause the most trouble to most homeowners in our area, and it's going to give them a lot of headaches and cost a lot of money. So be prepared if you got an ash tree. I'm Mark Kepler, Purdue University Extension Educator here in Fulton County. Every once in a while we get involved in what I call a bug event. That means when something comes into the area that really gets a lot of questions and affects a lot of different people. Right now we're dealing with an event that's come in here. Today is July 25th, and in the last few days I've gotten several calls on this insect. And this insect is called the army worm. And it truly comes by its name like it should have. An army, if you think about them marching along, that's what this insect does. So let's go backwards and see what happens. Coming out of the south is usually some moths. Hangs around down in Mexico in that area. They get up in the air and they start flying. They get up in the jet stream and they get coasted along in the jet stream. And then maybe a front or something comes in. And when that front hits them, they drop some moths down. And so wherever they happen to hit is just happenstance, just the circumstances that we're dealing with. And so once they get down, those moths lay eggs in grassy areas. They like grass. And because of that, they lay those eggs in this grassy area. Those eggs hatch out into worms, and the worms start feeding. And they get the name army worm because they just march. And they eat, and they eat, and they eat, and they march and march. And once this food's gone, they keep right on going. They march right across the road, making road slicks. They march across anything in their area in order to get onto that next blade of grass to get to. Sometimes we'll see this happening in wheat crops because wheat is a grass. Sometimes we find them in corn because corn is a grass. Or right here in this field that we're looking at, or this grass right here, we're seeing these army worms out here feeding along, and they're doing and consuming. And they just consume, consume, consume until they get to a good enough size, and then they'll develop into moths and fly away. And we got a problem this year, but we never may not have a problem another year. It just happens to be where the moths drop down. The moth, that's a good word to use, picks an area that's really grassy and comes into it. I had a call from somebody that they came out of the soybean field into their yard. And well, what happened was that soybean field was full of grass. They sprayed that grass and killed that grass down in that soybean field. Got to have something to eat. So they moved into the yard and started feeding on it. If you've got this, I want you to look out for it, especially in farm fields and corn fields and around lawns. We're seeing it in our area right now. If you find this, you need to probably get an insecticide that contains the active ingredients either permethrin or bifenthrin. Those are two different products out there that you can buy as concentrate, and you can spray upon these. And as you take a look at these, you'll just see they consume and consume, and there can be thousands of these in your yard. And so this is something you want to be on the guard for and take a look in your area to see if it's around. This is Mark Kepler, Purdue University Extension Service. If you need more information, our office is at the fairgrounds here in Rochester. We'll be happy to help you out.